Good morning, College Mennonite Church. Welcome to this time of gathering to offer our praise and devotion to God, whose presence and love goes beyond time and space. Today is the first Sunday of Lent 2021. Lent is the season of preparing ourselves for Easter. And Easter is a celebration of Jesus' resurrection and the new life power that God showed the world through Jesus. And when we get to Easter, how do we really celebrate something so contrary to human experience like resurrection? Well, the season of Lent gives us time and space to get ready. A gift of Lent is that we are forced to see ourselves as mortal. We as humans, as a human race, are probably more aware of our humanity now than at any time in the recent past. We pay attention to the air around us. We pay attention to how close we are to other people. We pay attention to what we've touched. We pay attention to how healthy we are feeling or not. We pay attention to the ache inside us, to see and be physically with people we love. And this, my friends, is a gift that can help us prepare for Easter. During this season of Lent, in our worship time, there will be some unique elements. There will be candles that help us mark the weeks leading up to Easter. There will be a prayer of confession, an affirmation of God's grace, and today, we also have communion together. If you've not already prepared your communion elements, don't worry, you have time. Communion happens after the sermon. Here, we have bread and juice. You may get the same, or you may only be able to find crackers and water, or cookies and milk, or conchos y café. This has been a year of creativity and doing the best with what we have because we are human. I invite you now to please join me in the call to worship. In the beginning, before time, before people, before the world began, God was here and now, among us, beside us, clearer than air, closer than breathing, God is. In all that is to come, when we have turned to dust and human knowledge has been completed, God will be. Not despairing of earth, but delighting in it. Not condemning the world, but redeeming it through Jesus Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit. God was, God is, God will be. And I'm guessing some of you who are regular viewers of What's Growing in CMC had an additional sentence pop in your head right there, and don't worry. Lent is a time of waiting and anticipating, and you will get to hear and say that sentence later on. Please join me now in singing Perdón, Señor, from Voices Together, number 153. This song will be our prayer of confession. We'll sing the verses in English and respond in Spanish. If you have your Lent candles nearby, I invite you to light those while I light the candles here. And remember, we started with 7 candles on Ash Wednesday, and in our countdown today, we light 6.
Señor, perdón, Señor.
our God of mercy, hears our confessions, forgives us, and sticks with us. Thanks be to God. Join again in singing the song Oceans with Kent Miller and Addie Lehman.
Abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. Your feet may fail and fear surrounds me.
As we gather in prayer, I invite you to remember, among others, Leonard and Irene Gross. As Irene fell on Saturday and has a broken pelvis, she will be in the hospital for a couple of days and welcomes visitors during visiting hours. Please join with me in opening your hearts and your hands in prayer to our loving God, our saving Jesus, and our guiding Holy Spirit. Creator, we give you thanks for all you are and all you bring to us. Your word, which summoned this world into existence, brought order out of chaos and beauty out of the formless. This word has infused the very air we breathe with the aroma of your love. In Jesus, you place the gospel in the center of this sacred circle through which all creation is related. You show us the way to live a generous and compassionate life. Christ Jesus, your love extends to the boundaries of the universe, yet is focused on humankind. In our weakness, worry, loneliness, hurt, and grieving, you welcome us into your loving and guiding arms. Enfold all those who seek your healing care and renewed strength. We remember today Virginia Sharp, Edie Casas, Irene Gross, and many others we carry on our hearts. Comfort all those who ache with grief. Christ Jesus, your love extends to the boundaries of humankind, to rich and poor, have and have-nots, oppressor and oppressed, and to so many more. We are all in need of your forgiveness. We all fall short, and we all miss the mark at times. You are with us. We pray for all your children, wherever they might be, in their joy and sorrow, fear and longing, pain and suffering, that your word might comfort, that your love heal and restore. We pray especially for the people of Texas and the struggles that they face due to extreme weather. You know others who struggle due to natural disaster, climate change, or the ravages of violence or war, and how your creation groans. Christ Jesus, your love breaks through, demands to be noticed, exposes that which has been hidden, reveals truth. We pray that your word, your love, might bring change and bring light into hearts and bring healing in creation wherever it is needed. Your love has influence wherever it is shown, a shoulder to lean on, a willing ear to listen, a task performed, a gift given, a selfless act. We pray for leaders near and far, for all those in positions of authority. Guide them in the way of your wisdom and compassion. Lead them in ways of your justice. Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, give us your strength to live together with respect, showing your love, living in your way as we grow in your spirit. For you are God, now and forever. Amen. children, I invite you to prepare for children's time with Talasha. And I invite all of us to join in singing When the Storms of Life Are Raging, which is number 595 in Voices Together and hymn 558 in the Blue Worship Hymnal.
Today, we have a story to tell that might sound a little bit familiar to you, and you are all going to help tell the story at home. So I've got my household up here so that we can kind of show what I mean with some of these things. And I will say, these guys haven't done it before, so they're in the same boat as you are with improvising this story together. All right, so be ready to move. You ready to move? You ready for me to move up there? All right, this camera's gonna have to do a little more work than usual. Well, it had been a long day. Jesus received the sad news that his cousin John, you know, John the Baptist, had been killed. And he tried to get some time alone to sit with that news. So go ahead and walk away from the people in the room with you. They may go off of the camera a little bit as they walk away from me. Yeah, he's trying to be by himself here, I think. But even as he walked away from the crowds followed him. Bunch together in your households. What happens if we all bunch together? So he taught the disciples, go ahead and sit down. This is how a teacher would teach disciples. Well, he taught the crowds, excuse me. So the disciples noticed that the crowds were getting kind of hungry, so Jesus fed them. You know, making those five loaves and two fish stretch to feed 5,000 people kind of took it out of Jesus. So when that was all done, he loaded the disciples into a boat and told them to head to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. Finally, alone, Jesus headed up the mountain to pray. Now, you need to head up something. So maybe you climb onto a piece of furniture if that's allowed at your house, or go to the top of some steps. We're going to go to the top of the steps here. Climb up as high as you can get up on a mountain to pray. Ah, alone at last. A chance to pray through all of the events and emotions of the day. Well, it was evening when Jesus arrived up that mountain, and he remained on the mountain until very early in the morning. And while Jesus was on the mountain, a storm brewed up. So make a storm. I've got some people here who are going to help me start with some sprinkles, and maybe someone keeps the sprinkles going while others add some more rain sounds. Ooh, and that storm brews up more. And it brews up even more. Maybe you have something you can clang at your house. Oh, listen to that storm. Blow some wind. Keep it going. The little boat the disciples were in was getting quite the beating. What should have been a quick trip across the sea was taking all night, and they were still far from the shore. As they worked to keep their little boat afloat and on course, a disciple suddenly called out, and they turned to look where she was pointing, and they saw a figure floating on the water, moving toward them. Look! Could this day get any stranger? It had to be a ghost! They began to shout and cry in fear. And then the figure spoke. Shh! Listen. Take heart. It is I. Do not be afraid. It was Jesus. Peter, who loved adventure, asked Jesus to let him come join him on the water. Come, Jesus said. And the disciples watched in amazement as Peter stepped out of the boat. Step out of your boat and into the swirling waters and began to walk toward Jesus. You can begin to walk. Peter walked, accelerated his eyes on Jesus, and then he began to think. Big mistake. Bring that storm back. Bring the storm back. Oh, he heard the thunder, and he smelled the stormy air, and he felt the wind, and he saw his feet stepping on tossing waves, and he panicked. He began to sink. He sank. He cried out, Lord, save me. And the words hadn't even left his mouth when he felt a gentle hand reach out and catch him. Stop the storm. Take the hand of someone in your household. As soon as Peter called for help, Jesus answered. Jesus helped him into the boat, and Jesus smiled at Peter. You have faith, Peter. It is growing and getting stronger. You were walking on water with me. But why did you start to doubt? Keep working on that, Peter. Jesus walked on the water. Peter tries and begins to sink. Jesus grabs his hand and the wind dies down. God loves every one of us, it's true, and God loves the universe. All right, let's pray together. God, you truly do miraculous things. You have given us this gift of faith, and it's growing and getting bigger and stronger in each one of us. I pray that we will be bold like Peter, and that we will reach out to you to walk with you, and that we'll reach out to you when we need help. Help us to keep growing in our faith. In Jesus' name, amen.
Phil Waite is our preacher for today, so please join me in a prayer of blessing for Phil and for all of us in this time. God, we thank you for Phil and for his commitment to follow you. May the words of his mouth and the meditations of our hearts grow into acts of love and justice and service towards you, towards our neighbor, towards our community and ourselves. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Grace to you and peace in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Gracias a ustedes y paz en el nombre de nuestro Señor Jesucristo. The scripture for us this morning is from Matthew 8. beginning with verse 23. And when Jesus got into the boat, his disciples followed him. A windstorm arose on the sea, so great that the boat was being swamped by the waves. But he was asleep. And they went and woke him up, saying, Lord, save us, we are perishing. And he said to them, why are you afraid, you of little faith? And he got up and rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a dead calm. They were amazed, saying, what sort of man is this, that even the winds and the sea obey him? The Gospels are filled with events, with stories about Jesus. There's some teaching, but a lot of it is just a series of stories. And those stories kind of lead into other stories, and questions get raised, like the one that was raised here, what sort of man is this? Well, like that question gets answered with another story that comes right after this. And these stories were important to the early church, and they're important to us. Right here is a mosaic. This mosaic looks like, I saw this, like, why? Well, that almost looks ancient. But it was done several years ago with the help of Joanne Brandt by some kids from College Mennonite Church. It's got eggshells, so it's eggshell. It's an eggshell mosaic that was made. And I don't know the history of the design, if it's an ancient design. My guess is that it probably, that there probably is an original mosaic like this, or maybe a series of mosaics like this. But what this mosaic represents to us is the power and importance that these stories have had for Christians through the centuries, from very early on. They are the building blocks, these stories, the building blocks of our faith. And we tell them to our children, and we tell them to each other throughout our lives. And they encourage us, and they comfort us. But the New Testament also does try to answer the questions that these stories raise. What sort of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey? It's an important question, right? It's a very important question. And Christians have been wrestling with this since the beginning of the Christian movement. Since the earliest days of Christian faith, Christians have been wrestling with this. And these stories that we have in the Gospels began as tradition, stories about Jesus that were passed on among Christians. And very early on, even before the Gospels were compiled, writers like the Apostle Paul began to try to answer this question, what sort of man is this? Is this Jesus? And what significance and meaning does it have for us? I'm going to refer to two of these attempts to answer this question. One is from Colossians. It's the first chapter of Colossians. And the answer to this question, what sort of man is this that even the wind and the sea obey? Well, he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And from Hebrews, the first chapter, the third verse,
He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. And he sustains all things by his powerful word. This phrase, which is the title of the sermon from Colossians, all things, in him all things hold together, is important, has been important for Christians through the centuries. And the phrase can have a range of meaning. It means all things cohere, all things make sense, all things find harmony and unity in Christ. That behind the veil, Christ is upholding creation, drawing, connecting and drawing things together and making sense of everything. Now, for every answer to a question like this about Jesus, there are more questions. And you maybe can think of dozens just off the top of your head, and I'm going to work with two this morning. One of those questions is, we're in the middle of a global pandemic. Things are not holding together. Things are falling apart. And if you're like me, you're sick of it. You're absolutely at the end of your rope with a pandemic. I'm tired of it, and I'm one of the, you know, I'm relatively fortunate and privileged, and I just about can't take anymore. I'm about done with the pandemic, although the pandemic's not done with me. That's the problem, right? I'm just tired of it. And I wake up in the morning, and I don't know how much more of this I can do. And maybe you feel that way. I feel that way, for sure. And I suspect, I'm not going to look around here and put people on the spot, but I guess some of us here in this room would be nodding their heads. At this time, we're just about done. All things don't seem like they're holding together. But I want to reframe that, if we might. And I know this might not be encouraging to you, but it's encouraging to me. Things could be worse. The world doesn't devolve into absolute and total chaos. Things could be better, for sure. But things still hold together. I was walking on water yesterday morning, you might say. It was a cold morning. It got very cold. It cleared off, and there was light winds. And I don't know, it must have been about 3 degrees Fahrenheit when I went out snowshoeing. With my poor dog Josh, who was not enthused about this, in the early morning, just as the sun was coming up, see his snowshoes walking on the snow. Snow is water. Get it? Walking on water. So I was out there, and it was dazzling. It was splendid. It was beautiful. It was unbelievable as the light came up in Shanklin Park and began to hit the woods, and the trees turned yellow with the light of that sun, and the frost on the trees sparkled, iridescent, refracting the colors of the rainbow. And I was walking through the woods along the Elkhart River. I love the Elkhart River. It's so beautiful. And there were ducks in the open waters of the river, but part of the river was frozen over, and everything was shimmery and dazzling, and the sky was blue, and as the sun came up, I began to feel its warmth, such as it was. Yeah, a little bit. We're relatively speaking here. There was warmth, and it was like a beautiful dance going on around me, and I was in the middle of it, and I was part of it. And I could feel my heart beating, the life inside of me that God created, like, and the blood pulsing through my veins, and the clarity of the air. And it was one of those moments where you realize that there is indeed something behind that veil holding things together. Beautiful. All things hold together in Him. Now, the other question that I want to address this morning, which you might have, which I have, is what possible significance or meaning any of this could have for you and for me in 2021? What possible meaning does all things hold together in Christ have for us? And I want to say, my response to that is, Christ is the organizing principle of everything. The organizing principle of creation. The organizing principle of the interaction within creation. The organizing principle of interaction among humans. Holding things together. The Lord of the dance. Drawing things together, making things cohere, bringing unity. Now, again, you might say, well, we humans aren't exactly living according to the dance. Sometimes it seems like the organizing principle of human society is not harmony, not cooperation, but competition. Sometimes it seems like the dance we're trying to do is stepping on each other's toes all the time. Like that's what we're about. Competition. And there's something to be said for that. We humans miss the mark. But the song still plays. Jesus still calls us, asking us to dance. Asking us to move in the rhythm that holds all things together in Him. Lent is a time when we remember that sometimes we don't dance to that rhythm. Sometimes we try to step on each other's toes. Sometimes we do it accidentally. Sometimes we don't hear the rhythm very well. And it's a time when we look at ourselves and look at our lives and we try to get back into that rhythm and move towards Christ. We try to remember that all things hold together, not in us, but in Him, and we listen. Listening is the most important kind of prayer. We often think of prayer as talking, as our words to God. And that's certainly part of prayer. But maybe a greater part of prayer is listening, being out along the river, listening. Paying attention to that voice, paying attention to that rhythm that holds all things together, paying attention to what brings unity and harmony to all things, that creates solidarity among creation, that creates solidarity among people, among humans. God calls the church as a vocation. God calls the church to be a sign, to be a witness, visible to what is invisible, a witness to that rhythm, living by that rhythm, showing the world that all things cohere in Christ. Giving testimony to the fact that all things hold together in Him. That's our calling. That's who we are. And we are called to listen always, to be attentive to that rhythm and to dance to it. And at the heart of the life of the church, at the very heart of the life of the church, is a ritual which goes by a number of names: Eucharist, Lord's Supper, Communion. But it's a ritual that serves for us as a sign that Christ holds all things together in Him, that there is union, that there is unity, that there is harmony, that there is a dance that's coherent, that makes sense. So as we partake this morning, remember that all things hold together in Him. And look at the world around you through the eyes of that confession, through the eyes of that faith, that all things hold together in Him. And we remember that in this meal that we share, in this sign, this ritual in which we partake, we remember the unity that we have with one another in Christ. And invite you, as you prepare your hearts, to join in singing "Fairest Lord Jesus."
Thank you.
Bring your communion elements, the bread and the cup, to your worship table. This is bread, made of many people's work, in a world where some have plenty and some go hungry. This is the fruit of the vine, crushed from many grapes, from a broken world which cries for healing. At this table, Christ feeds us out of abundance, and we share the cup of hope and the joy of salvation. Thanks be to God. Our homes may be filled with young voices, or our homes may be filled with overwhelming silence. This table might be brimming with family, or we may be sitting by ourselves at the empty table. But the table is never truly empty. Christ assures us that we are connected with each other and with Him like a vine and branches. And we cling to the imminent hope of once again seeing each other's faces and celebrating communion together again at some point. Now, out of gratitude to God, please bring your tithes and offerings, the gifts of money that you bring to God. You can do this online or by mailing your offering to the church office. Give with joyful hearts, returning to God the first fruits of your labors. God is with you. God is with us all. Open wide your hearts. We open them to new possibilities. From our dining room tables and our living room floors, this is the time to give our thanks and praise to God. It is right and always right to give you thanks and praise, Lord God. In your goodness, you created all things and gave them life. Therefore, we join our voices with the saints, past, present, and to come, and all the company of heaven, to praise your glorious name. It was a night filled with teachings and memories. Undoubtedly, tears were shed and laughter raised. This was the night before Jesus died. Jesus took bread, and he blessed it and broke it and gave it to his friends, saying, "Whenever you eat this bread, eat it in remembrance of me." Later, Jesus blessed a cup filled with the fruit of the vine. "Friends, this is the new covenant. Drink this to remember me. Drink to remember our time together." Join me in prayer. Spirit of God, surround the bread, surround the cup, surround the elements, no matter what form they take, and surround us, no matter where we are. God, your Spirit encircles these gifts with love. Bless these gifts, and in doing so, bless the connections between all here and all in our hearts. Bless the last and first, the poor in spirit, and the ones who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Make all your children in each space on earth feel your love and experience the winds of your righteousness. Now, we pray together as you taught us. Our Father, who is in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The body of Christ. Jesus says, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The cup of salvation. Jesus says, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Therefore, Almighty God, in remembrance of the life, death, and resurrection of your Son, we now celebrate the wonder of your grace, and so we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, and Christ will come again. Take the bread and the cup, eat and drink, taste and be filled with the goodness of the Lord. Thank you. Fed us with the bread of life and the cup of salvation. You have united us with Christ and one another. You have made us one with all your people in heaven and earth. Now, send us forth in the power of your Spirit that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and walk in the resurrection of Christ our Savior. Amen. Remember, we are earth, we are ashes, we are dust. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. And remember, the one who breathed life into dust recreates us. The one whose feet walked the earth gives us life. The one who cares for us beyond our comprehension gives us unending love. Go in peace, friends.